back. This is part three of Basic Excel. For this particular part of the lesson, or this particular part of the course, we're going to take a look at adding some more labels. We're going to look at basic formulas and a wee bit of function. So I'm back using Office 2013. I apologize for the video quality. I'm on an older laptop. I'd kind of like to, you know, use different equipment just to show versatility. So we're going to start with some labeling, some information that we're going to help us out with this. We're going to start by adding our expenses label. Expenses label. Now, if we wanted some more space or less space, we've got these two empty rows between our two areas of information. If I wanted to get rid of those two rows, I can click and drag to select the two rows. I click and drag on the numbers 6 to 7. Then I can right click and delete those rows if I don't need them. That's easy enough. And then just like you would click and drag to select and delete multiple rows, you can click and drag to insert multiple rows. So if I wanted those two rows back, I click and drag to select rows 6 and 7. With my mouse pointer still on either the 6 or the 7, I right click and insert, and it will insert that number of cells. So let me undo that and I'll show you. If I select, I don't know, 4, 5, or 6 rows, and then right click and insert, it inserts that many blank rows above where your active cell starts. And again, this is your active cell. In a selected range of cells, the white cell or non-shaded cell is actually your active cell. So I don't need that many rows in there, but two would be nice, just to get a little separation in there. Okay, a little separation. And then we're going to add some labels here. We're going to make this will be our jobs income. This is going to be our investments income, and we'll make this one our salary income. And then we'll come down here to our expenses, and we'll make the first one gas, and then food. We don't eat much. And then maybe this is entertainment, and we'll make this one miscellaneous. So there's all our labeling. Again, if you want to, and I discussed this, I believe it was in the last section, you can double click to auto size your columns. Okay. Now, when I double click to adjust column C, since it auto fits the largest item in that column, first quarter budget is here in cell C1. So that's why it made it significantly bigger than the other two. So we can fix that by turning this first quarter budget in C1 into a full range, full data range header. And we're going to do that by selecting cells A1 through F1, right? 6 cells, A1 through F1. Then we're going to come up here on the Home tab in the Alignment group, and we're going to click the Merge and Center button. What that does is it takes all 6 of those individual cells, combines them into one big cell, and then centers our text in the middle. So now, when I double-click the Resize column C, it resizes to fit the numbers because this is no longer in column C. It is now across the top completely. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to look at some basic formulas. So we're going to put our active cell here in cell C6. Well, let's add our S'more labels first, right? We're going to put totals here and totals here. I'm all about efficiency. If I don't have to type something in two different places, then why should I? So what we're going to do is we're going to use our non-adjacent cell selection. Remember that? Take your magic finger. First you select the first cell that you want to use. Then you take your magic finger, hold down the control key, and then you select the second cell that you want to enter the information into. So we're going to put the word total in both of these cells, but we're going to do it at the same time. So two cells selected, you simply type what you want to add into the active cell, which is again the non-shaded one, total. And here's the trick. Use your magic thumb this time, hold down the control key and press enter. And it puts that label in both cells. So again, I believe I used this example earlier, but if I select a whole group of cells and I put something in there and I do a control enter, it puts that same thing in all selected cells. So even if I have a bunch or a group of non-adjacent cells, same thing. Control enter and it puts that label in all selected cells. Even if it's just a number, right? Control enter, it puts that same number in all selected cells. So it works for values, it works for labels, we're not going to look at entering formulas into that kind of cell at this time, but we will look at some fun stuff when it comes to formulas. All right, so I show in my classes the wrong way to enter a formula first. It seems kind of odd, but believe it or not, I've known some people in the past, and I've been teaching this for a few years, who will do it this wrong way, and all it does is really it makes more work for the user. So the first thing to remember about formulas in Excel is that they all start with an equal sign, and then we put the actual numbers in here, right? 850 plus 1200 plus 2500. And when I click the enter button up here on the formula bar, you'll see it gives me my answer. So yeah, realistically, it does what it's supposed to do. It adds up the numbers that I told it to add up. But what if one of these numbers changes? What if this 850 is actually supposed to be 1850? When I change the value in the cell, it has no impact on my formula. So I would have to come in here and I would have to manually change my formula at the same time or subsequently. So you're doing twice the work. You're updating the cell value and you're updating your formula. That's not making Excel work for you. Excel is designed to automatically calculate and update when you use the proper format in your formulas. So I'm going to delete that. My recommendation when you're working in Excel with formulas and functions is anytime you can use a cell reference, you should use a cell reference. And what I mean by that is each of these cells has an address, right? This is C3. This is C4. This is C5. That's your cell reference. So if I want Excel to add the numbers in cells C3, C4, and C5, I can type equals. Now, this isn't the best way to do it, but this works. Equals C3 plus C4 plus C5. And you'll see it puts a little colored border around each of the cells that I specified with a matching color to the cell reference in the formula. Now, when I click my enter button, not only does it add up my numbers, but it also picks up the formatting. So it's displayed now as currency, to where when I just added the numbers, it stayed as general values. Okay, so that's one benefit. It picks up the formatting that you may have of the numbers that you're telling it to add together. Number two is if I change a value in one of those cell references, maybe I make this back to 850, as soon as I press enter, watch my formula down here, the value for my formula, it automatically updates. That's the power of Excel. That's making Excel work for you. You shouldn't have to do all these changes in the cells and in the formulas. That's just doubling your work. You might as well write it down on a piece of paper and add it up with a calculator. All right, so that's a better way. Another way to do that, I'll just get rid of this, would be to use the sum function. This is your first introduction with me to functions. Functions like formulas begin with an equal sign, and then you simply type what you think the function is. Well, sum is pretty easy. Sum. And then you'll notice that Excel gives you a list of possible functions down below where you started typing your function. So if you need to use sum if or sum ifs or sum product or one of these other ones, you simply use your arrow keys up and down to select the one that you want to use, and then you press the tab key. And that will automatically finish out your function. So for example, if I wanted sum if, when I press tab, it finishes the function, puts me in the arguments area. I don't want sum if, I want sum. Now all functions have argument areas. That's the left and right parentheses, and the arguments go inside. So essentially what this is saying is, okay, tell me where the numbers are that you want me to add up. And again, you want to use cell references here. So you put in the first number, which is, and it doesn't matter what order. I can start with C5. And I put a comma, right? Because the commas separate arguments. The next number I want is C4, comma. And you'll see it gives you these little tooltips down here to kind of help you out. Now it wants a number 3, if you have 3. If you're only doing 2, then you stop at 2. If you have 4 or 5, then you keep going, separating the arguments with commas. And then I put in C3. And then I close my argument areas. You always want to close your argument areas. And we'll learn more about that as we get into deeper functions, okay? But for every left parenthesis, you have to have a right parenthesis. Just something to keep in mind. I'm going to click my enter button up here, and there you'll see I get the exact same answer. So it's no biggie. Doesn't matter the order. Watch, I can do it. I can do sum, and I can do the middle one first, comma, and then the top one, comma, and then the bottom one. Close my parentheses, click the enter button, same thing. Okay, same thing. It doesn't matter what order you put them in. As we get deeper into formulas, you'll understand or you'll realize or I'll tell you that Excel follows the order of operations. So you don't have to worry about putting stuff in parentheses. It's automatically going to do parentheses and then multiplication. Wait. Parentheses, exponents, multiplication, division, subtraction, and addition. Right? The please excuse my dear Aunt Sally thing. So you don't have to worry about parentheses, unless you just want to do it to make it look good, then you can put your stuff in parentheses. All right, so that was nice. Maybe some of you have some experience in Excel and you say, well, Scott, why don't you just use the auto sum button? And that's a valid point. Over here is the auto sum button. It's in the editing group of the home tab. It's a frequently used button. When you click the auto sum button, Excel is going to first look above it to see if there's numbers up there to add together. If it finds no numbers above it, then it's going to look to the left to see if there's numbers over there to add together. If there's nothing above and nothing to the left, it just throws its hands up and says, I don't know what you want from me. And I can demonstrate that by putting my sum function over here. Oops. That's wrong. Auto sum. See, it's there's nothing above it, so it looked to the left. And I mean it reached way out to the left. So if I just drop this down one and do auto sum, there's nothing above, there's nothing to the left. So it's waiting for you to put in the numbers or the cell references that you wanted to add together. But as long as you're adjacent to the numbers you want to add together, click auto sum one time, verify that yes, indeed, these are the numbers I want added up, and then you can click auto sum a second time and you're done. So that's pretty easy. There's another way to do the exact same thing. There's a keyboard shortcut, and that keyboard shortcut is hold down the Alt key and then press the equals key. There you go. It throws in the sum function, looks around for the proper numbers. If everything is good, then you can do Alt equals again, and you're done. So that's even quicker for those of you that like to use the keyboard. Now, if you're going to add or enter the same function in multiple cells, right? I want to put the sum function in these three cells, and I also want to put it in these three cells. Well, maybe I want to put it in these two cells and these three cells all at the same time. I want my monthly totals. I want my categorical totals. Then you select all the cells where you want to do an auto sum, hold down the Alt key, press equals, and just like that, it fills in all of your totals. Okay. So speaking of monthly totals, we don't have anything up here that specifies our months of the year. So since this is our first quarter budget, we'll go with a fiscal year. And that kind of carries us into lists. In Excel, there are four built-in lists. The first built-in lists that I'm going to show you anyway, they're in no particular order. If I want to start this with September, I type in the three-letter abbreviation for September, S-E-P. And then I grab the fill handle. Remember the fill handle? It's this little square at the bottom corner of our active cell. When you hover your mouse over it, it changes to the small plus sign. Then you click and drag that either to the left or right or up and down, whichever direction you want to go. And you can see by the little tooltips underneath, it's going to put October in that cell and November in that cell. So that's one of the built-in lists. And you can start at any point in that list. It goes January through December. So if I start J-A-N and then use my fill handle and copy that down, you see once I get to December, if I keep dragging, it'll just start repeating. So you can put in however many months that you need. All right. So that's the abbreviated months of the year. It also has the full months of the year. So if I want to start in July here, I can grab the fill handle, copy that down. You can see it carries on, gets to the end of the year, and then it just keeps filling in for the next year, right? So this would be July of this year to October of next year. So you can go as far as you need to with these lists. The third list is the abbreviated days of the week. So Monday, M-O-N, click and drag down, and there you'll see it fills in the rest of the days of the week. And again, it'll just keep repeating over and over and over again for however many days of the week you need. And it also has, guess what else it has? Yep, you got it, the full day of the week. Maybe I want to start this week on Saturday. Click and drag down, and it'll fill in the full days of the work, repeating once you get to the end of the list. So these are the four built-in lists. Once we get into, I believe it's the intermediate, maybe it's the advanced course, I don't remember, we'll get into creating custom lists. So that's where we get our September, October, November. It just makes things easier for you. So if you wanted to repeat that down here, September, and it follows capitalization. So if I don't capitalize, then it won't capitalize either. If I want all capitalized, SEP, then it will continue all capital. So that's kind of handy. I don't think we need those down there. We don't need double. But we do want total in here as well. So we'll put a total up there. So we have our labels. We have our additional labels here. We have our labels for the months of the year, our total labels. We've looked at adding numbers together, simple addition, put the numbers in, plus, plus, plus. Not a good idea. I do recommend, like I said earlier, that anytime you can use cell references in your formulas or your functions, that you use cell references. That way, if you need to change something, it automatically adjusts the formulas involved with that number. Okay, so that's the power of Excel. Oops, I guess I need to take this down one more, don't I? I can use the fill handle to copy these formulas down. That's easy enough to do. And it does that because of our relative cell references. We're going to talk more about cell references later. So not to worry about that right now. So I think we're going to call this section done. This is a good place to stop. When we come back for the next section, then we will take a look at our remaining mathematical functions, subtraction, multiplication, and division. Maybe look at a little more formatting, and then we'll just carry on with the remainder, which is going to be charts and graphs and a little bit more worksheet stuff. So with that, I'll say stay safe, stay healthy, be happy, and I'll talk to you later. Bye-bye.